Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Superconductivity, a very short introduction by Stephen J. Blundell, narrated by L.J. Ganser.
Chapter 1. What is superconductivity? Is it a bird? Is it a plane? No, it's Superman! Clark Kent's alter ego was conceived in the 1920s, and the name Superman owed more than a little to Nietzsche's concept of an Übermensch, an overman who would rule over inferior beings. The superhero thus began life as more morally ambiguous than the champion of good and defender of the helpless that he later became. Nevertheless, he was created at a time when the prefix super was beginning to be used to enhance all manner of concepts. Until the 20th century, super was usually found in rather technical words. Superannuation, supererogatory, superposition, supervise, and superintendent. But the era that launched the Caped Crusader also provided supermarket, supertanker, and superstar. Later came supercomputer, superglue, supergrass, supermodel, superpower, supersize, and the superstore. More recently, the MRSA bacterium has become a hospital superbug. When Kamerling Onnes, working in his Leiden laboratory in 1911, discovered a strange phenomenon affecting the properties of mercury at very low temperature, he christened it supergeleider. When translated from Dutch into English, it became supraconductivity, but this rapidly mutated into superconductivity. Though Onnes' naming predated Superman by more than a decade, the spirit was rather similar. Just as the comic book hero could defy gravity in a way no mere man could, the superconductor could defy the usual laws of electricity in a manner never before achieved by any known material. Superconductors were not just better than ordinary conductors of electricity. They were of a completely different order, as strange and mysterious as a visitor from the planet Krypton wearing underpants over his trousers. Materials can be classified in terms of how well they conduct electricity. Metals, like copper and gold, are good conductors of electricity and are used for making wires. The electrons in a metal are able to easily travel around. Many, though not all, plastics and rubbers tend to be poor conductors of electricity and are classified as insulators. The electrons in an insulator are fixed in place and are not able to travel around easily. Insulators can be used to make the shielding that is wrapped around wires so that you don't electrocute yourself when you touch the outside of a cable. In between the extremes of metals and insulators are semiconductors, a 19th century term expressing the halfway house nature of these beasts, and examples include silicon and germanium. Semiconductors behave very much like insulators, but they can be persuaded to conduct electricity by adding impurities, and they find uses in transistors and computer chips. Onnes' discovery, though, was something else entirely. To appreciate how bizarre superconductivity is, imagine making a coil of superconducting wire and somehow passing an electrical current around it. Never mind for a moment how you would do this, we will get to that later. What you would find is that the electrical current would keep going round and round the coil forever. Once started, the current keeps on going. Batteries are not included for this experiment because you wouldn't need them. You can retreat to a safe distance and watch the extraordinary sight of a current going round and round, all by itself, with no power source driving it. This looks like perpetual motion, a concept which down through the ages is normally associated with fools and charlatans. But this is no conjuring trick. It has been done. People have set electrical currents going round and round superconducting coils for years, and even decades. And with no source of power, the currents keep going all by themselves for as long as anyone can be bothered to do the experiment. Superconductivity is a phenomenon that simply did not exist before the 20th century. There was no hint or sign, and barely any suspicion that such a thing might be possible. Yet, as we shall see, The seeds of the discovery of superconductivity were planted early in the 19th century. Once superconductivity was discovered, it would take nearly half a century for a satisfactory theory explaining it to be developed, and the succeeding half a century would throw up surprising experimental puzzles, which would show that our understanding of the effect is far from complete. Nevertheless, these coils of superconducting wire which carry electrical currents all by themselves are used daily in MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, scanners in hospitals throughout the world, and in the maglev trains in Japan. Superconductivity actually works and earns its living every day of the year. To see how superconductivity is fundamentally different from normal behavior, consider the following. When a wire carries an electrical current, it gets hot, an effect known as joule heating, named in honor of the 19th century Lancashire brewer-turned-scientist James Prescott Joule, who discovered it. The effect is normally small, but in a fuse, the heat generated by a large unwanted current causes the fuse wire to melt and break the circuit. Fuse breaking is a dramatic effect, but all wires would act like fuses if they were thin enough. Wires have to be made sufficiently thick so that the heating due to the current which they carry is small enough so that they don't melt and break. Why do wires heat up when they carry current? To understand this, think of the carriers of electrical charge in a metal. The electrons as a swarm of angry bees, each one zipping around in some apparently random direction. Driving a current is like trying to gently waft the swarm in a particular direction by subjecting them to a breeze, so that even though each bee is rushing back and forth at great speed, the swarm as a whole drifts along with the breeze. However, the bees keep bumping into things, slamming into tree branches and hedges, and even though each emerges unscathed, these collisions dissipate energy and serve to heat up ever so slightly the objects with which the bees collide. It is this transfer of energy from the cloud of electrons into the surrounding atoms that means that a lot of the Earth's precious energy is wasted in heating up the miles of power cables that crisscross our cities and connect them to power stations. These collisions are responsible for heating up the elements in our kettles and the wires in our toasters, applications in which the heating effect is put to good use. But in power cables, the joule heating is just a waste of energy. However, in superconductors, the joule heating is entirely absent. It is as if the friction has been turned off, and the crowd of angry bees waft gently through the garden without bumping into anything. A superconductor can carry a current with no electrical resistance, and so, somewhat counterintuitively, you can cause a current to go round and round a superconducting coil forever and ever without supplying any power. If superconductors could be made to operate at room temperature, it could revolutionize the way we supply electricity to people's homes and have many important consequences for our technology. Kamerlingh Onnes realized this soon after the discovery of superconductivity and envisaged making superconducting wires and winding them into coils. These could then act as large electromagnets, producing large magnetic fields without needing any source of energy to drive them. Today, this dream has become a reality. The large magnets used in hospital MRI scanners are made of coils of superconducting wire. However, there is a fly in the ointment. For superconductivity to occur, the material has to be cooled to a very low temperature. In fact, as we will describe in the next chapter, it was only by the development of methods to cool matter to extremely low temperatures that superconductivity was discovered at all. We now know that it might be possible to get superconductivity to work at room temperature, but although we are more than halfway to achieving that goal, we still do not know how to do it. Temperature is a quantity that is measured by certain scales. The Fahrenheit scale, dating back to 1724 and still used in the United States, and the Celsius scale, which was developed about 20 years later and is widely used in Europe. Both scales are based on setting certain values to the fixed points defined by the freezing point and boiling point of water. Of course, other substances boil at different temperatures, and these temperatures can be measured on these scales. Daniel Gabriel Fahrenheit's original scale used the temperature measured under a human armpit as one of its three fixed points, while Anders Celsius' original scale had two fixed points, but was curiously arranged upside down. 0 degrees was set as the boiling point of water, with 100 degrees as the freezing point of water, so that hotter temperatures meant lower numbers, a feature corrected by the Swedish botanist and taxonomist Carl Linnaeus. In any case, during the 19th century, it was realized that temperature quantifies the degree to which a system can vibrate and fluctuate by exchanging energy with its environment. Warmer molecules jiggle around more than cold ones. At a certain temperature, found to be minus 273.15 degrees Celsius, minus 459.67 degrees Fahrenheit, and known as absolute zero, all vibrations cease. Lord Kelvin defined a new temperature scale, one which bears his name, as simply the Celsius scale shifted by 273.15 degrees. Hence, absolute zero becomes zero Kelvin, abbreviated to K, and the freezing point of water becomes 273.15 K. Although Celsius and Fahrenheit are convenient scales for discussing the weather, we will use Kelvin in this book as the numbers are more suitable for discussing the low temperatures at which superconductivity occurs. And it is now the Kelvin scale which forms the absolute standard from which the Celsius and Fahrenheit scales are derived. It was the quest for low temperatures in the 19th century which paved the way for the discovery of superconductivity in the 20th century. Chapter 2. The Quest for Low Temperatures. Liquefying Gases. Though superconductivity was not discovered until 1911, the origins of the discovery can be traced back at least to the early 19th century and the work of Michael Faraday in the Royal Institution in London. At age 20, Faraday, an apprentice bookbinder from a poor family, had managed to secure a job at the Royal Institution as scientific assistant to the eminent chemist Sir Humphrey Davy, mainly on the strength of presenting to Davy a bound version of the notes Faraday had taken at some of Davy's public lectures. Though Davy's wife persisted in treating Faraday as a servant from the lower classes, and Davy himself was later to block Faraday's progress in the scientific establishment as he realized his own eminence was about to be eclipsed, Faraday was forever grateful and devoted himself to a life of constant hard work in the laboratory. Though he is best remembered for his work in electromagnetism, optics, and electrochemistry, it was his accidental discovery of how to make liquid chlorine that was to be of such importance in the road to superconductors. Chlorine had been discovered in 1774 by Carl Scheele, and was thought to contain oxygen because of its strong oxidizing properties. It was thus named oxymuriatic acid, muriatic acid being what we now call hydrogen chloride, HCl. Davy had triumphantly shown that oxymuriatic acid did not react with hot carbon, and thus contained no oxygen, and pronounced it an element, naming it chlorine after its greenish-yellow color. Chlorine gas was later to make a somewhat mixed contribution to human happiness, following its use in disinfecting swimming pools and killing soldiers in the trenches of the First World War. However, it was a compound of chlorine which was to lead to a discovery that is very significant for our story. In 1811, Davy had shown that the crystals obtained by passing chlorine gas through a nearly freezing dilute solution of calcium chloride were a compound of chlorine and water, chlorine hydrate, Cl2H2O. In the winter of 1823, at Davy's suggestion, Faraday performed what turned out to be some crucial experiments on chlorine hydrate. "I took advantage of the late cold weather to procure crystals of this substance," he described in his report. Faraday placed the crystals in a sealed glass tube, the upper end of which was then hermetically closed. He heated the tube and noted the formation of a colored oily liquid on subsequent cooling. The best results were performed using a bent tube. He heated one end with the chlorine hydrate in it and allowed the oily liquid to condense in the cold end, which was submerged in crushed ice. By performing experiments on this liquid, Faraday realized that what he had made was liquid chlorine. We now understand that chlorine gas needs to be cooled to about minus 34 degrees Celsius to liquefy, and this is colder than any winter Faraday was likely to encounter in London. However, the high pressure produced by decomposing the chlorine hydrate, which occurs on heating it in the sealed tube, was enough to raise the boiling point of chlorine to the temperature in Faraday's laboratory. The same effect, only in reverse, is responsible for the poor quality of tea that one can brew at the top of mountains. The reduced air pressure lowers the boiling point of water, so that less flavor is extracted from the tea leaves. Faraday had shown that a substance previously known only in the gaseous form could be turned into a liquid. He now wondered whether he could perform the same trick with other gases. Through further experimentation, it was found that this technique of producing high pressures in a sealed tube allowed one to liquefy other gases, including ammonia, NH3, hydrogen sulfide, H2S, nitrogen dioxide, NO2, sulfur dioxide, SO2, and carbon dioxide, CO2. Carbon dioxide misses out the liquid phase at normal pressures. Solid CO2 turns straight into gaseous CO2 when you heat it, a process called sublimation, and is used as dry ice, particularly in cheesy music videos. Faraday's work was pioneering, but though he was the first person to liquefy a chemical element, the compound ammonia had in fact first been liquefied using pressure back in 1787 by the Dutch chemist Martinus van Marum. However, despite intensive effort, there were certain gases, including hydrogen, nitrogen, and oxygen, that Faraday was unable to liquefy using this technique, and for this reason he called them permanent gases. In the 1860s, the Belfast-born physicist Thomas Andrews studied the liquefaction of gases in great detail. He formulated the conditions under which liquefaction could occur, connecting these conditions to the gas laws which relate the pressure, temperature, and volume of the gas. It was then realized that the only reason that the so-called permanent gases had stubbornly resisted liquefaction was simply that the pressures available in a Faraday-style experiment were insufficient to raise their boiling temperatures up to room temperature. A more cunning approach was needed, and it came by accident. A sudden release. Louis-Paul Cailleté was the son of a metallurgist and had set up a laboratory at his father's iron foundry. Cailleté had extended Andrew's work and had made careful measurements of how the properties of gases deviated from the laws proposed by the Dutch physicist Johannes van der Waals. In the 1870s, using his souped-up version of Faraday's tried and trusted method of applying high pressure, Cailleté began his attempt to turn gases into liquids at room temperature, identifying acetylene, C2H2, as a likely candidate. It was expected that a pressure of about 60 atmospheres was needed to produce the desired effect. But during the pressurization, his apparatus sprang a leak, and the compressed gas escaped. Cailleté had been watching carefully, and noticed that as the gas escaped through the leak, a faint mist had formed, only to rapidly disappear. He initially suspected this must be water vapor, and that his sample of acetylene had been impure. But repetition of the experiment with a more carefully purified sample of acetylene produced the same result. He realized that the sudden release of pressure in the gas had cooled it and resulted in a temporary condensation of liquid. Very high pressure wasn't necessary to liquefy gases. You could do it by suddenly releasing the pressure. Cailleté had the gumption to realize that this was a breakthrough and quickly set about trying to liquefy something more interesting than acetylene. He started with oxygen because he could make a reasonable quantity in a pure state, pressurized it to 300 atmospheres, and cooled his glass apparatus to minus 29 degrees Celsius with evaporated sulfur dioxide, suddenly releasing the pressure produced a mist of condensing droplets of liquid oxygen. He reported his results to the Academy of Sciences in Paris in December 1877, only to find that at the same time they had received a report of a similar discovery by the Swiss chemist Raoul Pierre Pictet, based in Geneva. Pictet, who had been motivated to liquefy gases in order to produce artificial ice for food preservation, had achieved the same result but by a quite different cascade method, which consists of liquefying gas which has been pre-cooled in the liquid of another substance that has in turn been produced from gas itself pre-cooled by another liquid. In this way, a succession of harder-to-liquefy gases can be produced. Two methods were thus available to liquefy gases, and it seemed that the quest to liquefy the permanent gases was nearly at an end, Cayeté furthering the quest by liquefying nitrogen and carbon monoxide. Many copies of Cayeté's apparatus were manufactured in Paris, since Cayeté was very open about all his experimental details and admirably keen to see his results repeated and extended. One set was bought by a Polish scientist called Zygmunt Florenti Wróblewski, who was taking up the chair of the Faculty of Physics at the Jagiellonian University in Krakow. There, Wróblewski began an initially fruitful partnership with a colleague in the chemistry department, Karol Olszewski, and by making some modifications to Cayeté's equipment, they were able to do more than simply produce a fine mist of liquid droplets of oxygen. In March 1883, they produced liquid oxygen quietly boiling away by itself in a test tube. 2 weeks later, they repeated the trick with liquid nitrogen, and Krakow instantly became the world-leading center of low-temperature physics. Unfortunately, Wróblewski and Olszewski had a serious falling out, and their professional relationship broke up after a further 6 months. Thereafter, they worked independently in their own departments, despite working on precisely the same project, that of attempting to liquefy hydrogen. Toiling late one night in his laboratory in 1888, Wróblewski upset a kerosene lamp on his desk and was so badly burned he died soon afterwards. Olszewski continued to work on low-temperature problems, developing an improved Pictet-style apparatus. The principle of cooling by rapid expansion had been established much earlier, in 1852, by James Prescott Joule, together with the Belfast-born mathematical physicist William Thomson, later to be known as Lord Kelvin. Their effect is known either as the Joule-Thomson effect, or, reflecting Thomson's later elevation, as the Joule-Kelvin effect. It works because as a gas expands, the average distance between molecules increases, and this alters the effect of the weak intermolecular attractive forces. It turns out that the Joule-Thomson effect only leads to cooling if the gas is already at a lowish temperature. But, this complication notwithstanding, the effect is hugely important for liquefying gases. One method of getting gases to expand was by allowing high-pressure gas to squirt out of a fine nozzle, or constriction, into a region of low pressure. This would cool the gas, allowing it to liquefy, and any cold gas remaining could be recompressed and forced around a circuit and back into the high-pressure vessel. In this way, a steady flow process could be produced, and a gas liquefier could be constructed that could chug away nicely by itself, steadily producing precious drops of extremely cold liquids. This feat was perfected by Karl Paul Gottfried von Linde, who in the early 1870s had set up an engineering laboratory in Munich. Rudolf Diesel, inventor of the diesel engine, was one of the students. His work on refrigeration led to the development of the Linde gas liquefier, and his first commercial refrigeration system was patented and installed in 1873. He founded Linde's Ice Machine Company in 1879, which is now the Linde Group, and at the time of writing, the world's largest industrial gas company with annual sales of well over 10 billion euros. By the mid-1870s, the most important known gases had been liquefied, apart from one, hydrogen. This had stubbornly refused to liquefy, though the Krakow scientists had seen some fine droplets, but it was not clear if these had been impurities. However, there was one unknown gas that was to prove more important to liquefy, and this was the first element to be discovered beyond the Earth. A new element on the Sun. In 1868, the French astronomer Pierre Janssen was in India, studying the spectrum of light coming from the Sun's chromosphere, a thin layer of the Sun's atmosphere, during a total solar eclipse. He noticed a bright yellow line with a wavelength of 587.49 nanometers, which was initially assumed to be due to sodium. Later that year, the same line was observed by the English astronomer Norman Lockyer, later to be the first editor of the journal Nature. Lockyer concluded that this spectral line must be due to a new element, unknown on Earth but present on the Sun. He and Edward Frankland, a professor of chemistry at the Royal Institution, named the element helium, from the Greek word for the sun, helios. In 1895, the Scottish chemist William Ramsay isolated helium in the laboratory of University College London by treating the mineral clevite with mineral acids. Ramsay was looking for argon, but after separating nitrogen and oxygen from the gas liberated by sulfuric acid, noticed a bright yellow line that matched the line observed in the spectrum of the sun. Lockyer and the physicist William.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.